What was your, I mean, initial reaction hearing this news about Bed Bath & Beyond filing for bankruptcy after they've had, you know, struggles for the last year or so?
Not really surprised. They joined the growing number of retailers that are really struggling in a post-COVID world, in a dynamic retailing environment where shoppers have kind of switched to e-commerce, but have come back to the stores, and they've had a record of really struggling over the last few years.
Is this a new trend where maybe people are just not going to shop in person as much? And so if you can't switch to e-commerce, you maybe just can't survive?
It's one of those answers where it depends. It really kind of depends on the season. It depends on where it's meeting customers where they want to be. I think if you look at some of their other competitors that have had to kind of figure out how to make the in-person experience a dynamic one, you can see where curbside pickups and just ways that still draw people to the store are working really well. And it's also, it's supply chain. People aren't going to come to the stores if there's empty shelves. And Bed Bath & Beyond has been struggling with paying their vendors, getting product on the shelves. And then also they've had some other areas where they have just really tried to struggle and kind of flip that switch to maintain competitive with their rivals.
When you talk about that dynamic change, what do you mean by that?
Well, they were known for at one point, that was like the go-to place for you're having a wedding, you know, or even with their, they also have 120 of the Bye Bye Baby stores, which really aren't as popular here in Rhode Island, but are more prominent in other states where you would go for like a baby registry. But other e-commerce competitors started with those registries. So Wayfair and Amazon. And then the traditional bricks and mortars were also able to switch where you could then, you know, you have people coming in from other states, you can register. And then the other aspect that they had was they started going away from their brand. They started becoming a little, I think, a mixed, is this feeling like a Walmart or a Target where, you know, I'm here to buy nail polish and I'm here to buy protein bars in addition to register for these towels. And then also where the other retailers really kind of sunk in their heels and were able to get some footing was private labels. And they were very slow to try to get consumers to want to buy those types of products.
From a marketing perspective, what are some of the challenges when they're maybe branding and it's like unclear what exactly it is you're going to the store for?
Well, that's a problem. What brand equity do you own? Like where, what place in the consumer's mind do you own? It's that perception for a consumer. Like this is the place where I go get X or Y. Now it's a place like where do I get everything I need under one roof? And then they also got themselves stuck in that discount cycle with couponing and expecting that was the go-to place to have a coupon.
What kind of challenges does that present with couponing and trying to always be the discount place?
It's a really hard place to navigate because if you're constantly chasing that lowest price, you have other competitors with stronger supply chains and more negotiating power that are going to win every time. So now you're already dealing with margins and supply chain. It just really adds to a very complicated mix of trying to manage shareholders and a bottom line and to keep stock prices up and to keep consumers coming into the stores.
So with these stores eventually now closing, what kind of impact does that have on the market?
Oh my gosh, they have between, so Bye Bye Baby is 120 stores, Bed Bath & Beyond is 360 stores. So that's a huge impact to a local economy. But I think May 9th is really the pivotal point to see if they're going to be able to keep those stores open and to be able to keep those stores in operation until they can get somebody to come in to try to help them with infusing some money into their stores to be able to pay their vendors and get products on the shelf and try to turn this around.
Is that something you think would be possible after filing for bankruptcy and kind of going through this process for them to be able to come out on top of it in the end?
It's possible. Anything's possible. If they can, again, get people into the stores and actually have product, you know, from a retail perspective, if I'm coming to a store and there's no product on the shelves, it's a missed opportunity. I don't really have another opportunity to try to sell you. You're going to go to the store down the street because you want it now. You don't want to wait 2 days or 3 days or 5 days to get that product that you need immediately. You know, you want to buy off that registry, you know, you waited to the last minute, or, you know what I mean? You're doing spring clean, whatever you're doing. You want that product when you want it. That's the reason why you're going to the store.
As opposed to ordering it online, which, you know, then you're waiting anyway.
Yeah. But even if you look at, you know, other competitors, you can even get same day delivery if you really want it today. Or, okay, maybe I'm going to wait 24 hours to be able to see it on my doorstep.
Yeah. Wow. Is there anything else you want to add you think is important, you know, when there are these kind of major retailers going through these cycles?
I think it's that they've really got to kind of hone in and find their identity. And that's what they've been struggling with, is that you've really got to figure out what you do well and do it better than somebody else. I think when you dilute your brand and your selling, you know, nail polish and towels, and you're just trying to figure out the national brands and the private label brands, they have to have a solidified strategy that really kind of carve out why you want to go to those stores. Who knows? Maybe it's the place that you go to for babies and registries. You know, it's the kind of the go-to place. I mean, especially in some of the states where we're missing that baby registry place to go and to kind of pick out those items.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. It could just be an opportunity for them to try to salvage, especially the footprints and the square footage that they have in these stores. It's very costly to run.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate you taking the time.
Oh, I hope they make it. So the big date to watch is their shareholders meeting is on May 9th. So that'll be the next pivotal piece of the story and kind of where it's going to go.
Okay. And then after that, I mean, what are their options, I guess?
Oh my gosh. So if they don't get funding, if they don't get somebody to save them, so they already were looking for funding partners and they've lost two of them already. So part of the problem is too, is like once their stock dips below a dollar, then NASDAQ has got a problem and these funding partners pull out.
Mm-hmm.
So they're on their third, I think this year, their partner to try to help them to be able to pay the bills and get themselves back up and running. So if that, it's like, it starts to be a domino effect. If they can't get the approval with the shareholders meeting on May 9th, they can't get a funding partner, then they're going to have to start to look off like selling their assets and figuring out what the new norm for them looks like.
Okay.